Let's go back to your story. 25% vision. You could not smell and taste. Am I right?
Correct.
Okay.
I still cannot smell.
You cannot smell?
No.
Okay. So, from that point of time, what does it take to fight what everyone says is not possible? What is that fire in between, which actually is this word motivation, which people have used left, right and center and abused left, right and center? What is motivation and what motivated you?
Motivation, to be honest, and to break it down, because it's such a, like you say, overused word, it has to remain very consistent. And the thing is, it's very hard to say I'm going to be motivated for the next 100 days. So what you do when you break it down to a hack is that you remain motivated to get to tomorrow. And tomorrow is the goal. And a good tomorrow. So what is the success? What is it? Because when you look at success in a very large, large sort of way, it overwhelms you. And the way I was, I mean, I wasn't even off the bed yet. You know what I'm saying? And I was thinking about traipsing across my university in the US and joining a sorority.
All those dreams that you had were shattered, powdered like the skull. Yeah. Okay, and then tell me what that period was like. How did you come back to any sense of normalcy?
Very good question. So my dad searched and searched and searched for doctors who would do the job. But you know, you had somebody who could do, say, this but not that. So you needed actually a team of doctors, somebody who would deal with the eyesight, somebody with the face, somebody with the possible meningitis which was coming. And they just weren't the doctors here in India to do it. So we had to, so I mean, all credit to him, he found two doctors, one in Germany, one in Chicago. And he was like, to fix the situation. And we were running out of time because we needed to save what little vision I had left.
Okay.
If we had let the pressure build in the brain, it would have all gone. And you know, so we've decided to go with Chicago since we don't know any German. So we were like, let's not.
Except Adolf Hitler, that's all we know about Germany.
So it's like, let's not try that. And the thing is, I always had, my spirits were never down during the initial days, but because I actually did not know the extent to what had happened.
Correct.
I was just trying to get, because I...
Thank God you didn't know so much, and sometimes ignorance is bliss. You know, because you didn't understand too much of the science of it, I think you were ready to fight back.
I was. Because I just needed to, okay, how do we get to Chicago?
Yeah.
That was the big deal.
You know, ma'am, if I'll keep butting in between,
please,
because
please.
I'm coming with that time and today's time. Today when we have a small headache, the first thing we do is Google. If you had Googled your story at that point of time, the answer that life would have given you, or you would have answered, life would have been very different.
Oh my God, thank God there was no internet.
Exactly.
Man. Like, I don't think any answer would have been good, and I don't think we would
have been... Exactly. It starts working on your mind. Okay. Right, so you had two options. You chose US.
We chose the US, and we left.
Hail Trump, yeah.
But one point to remember is I had still not seen myself in the mirror yet.
Okay.
Because I wasn't getting off the bed.
Hmm.
So I was still somehow in my little 18-year-old brain, thought that I would get everything back the way I had imagined it, and suddenly fast forward to on campus and we'd be back in
back
the
is life to normal. That's what you believe.
Yes,
that
is what I believed. And I'm so fast forward to reaching the US. I think when we landed there, the immediacy with which they needed to operate was critical. So obviously my dad wasn't carrying around old pictures, you know what I'm saying? So it was like, oh, this is what she looked like. So they just went in and created the face, or started to build back or reclaim the face of a girl they had never seen before.
So the way you look today and the way the 18-year-old about to be Anjali was is completely different?
I would say extremely different.
So when we were so particular about, my nose is like this, my lips are like this, my ears. So that Anjali and this Anjali look completely different.
Correct.
And today they think completely different.
I would say so.
Yeah.
I think she was a very charmed child. She was very, everything was perfect.
No, the charm still loses, man. You still have a lot of charm with your speech and the way you carry yourself. It's brilliant and admirable. But as we move on, tell me, the operation was done successfully, obviously.
We had multiple of those. So this is a very iterative process. So one of the concerns, or the things that came up as, you know, a challenge, is that they can't do everything in one shot. Because when
they go in,
you will find out how many problems there are.
Yeah.
And so when they went in, so this 455 powdery situation, you have to take it and throw it. And you have to, so I have a lot of metal in my face. So they've used a lot of titanium to rebuild. They've regrafted a lot of like cartilage and fat and whatever. So, you know, I was like, yeah, take it out of every other place.
You know, every 18-year-old girl, every 18-year-old boy, anyone, they're so particular about the way they look and, you know, how they were. They had cherished those memories. When you looked at the mirror for the first time, I remember you said this in one of your famous TED Talks, that using the wheelchair or going to the bathroom by yourself was such a commendable achievement.
Gold medal. Yeah. Epic.
That's what it was. And that's how serious the damage was. But when you looked at yourself, psychologically, mentally, what was the first thing you felt? Were you like, who am I?
This is not me.
Yeah.
That's what came. This is not me. Somebody tell me this is not happening. And I was just like, I'm going to have to, and then the next thing was like, am I going to have to live with this person for the rest of my life? Who is she? And then, you know, I kind of, the next few years of my life, I lived my life in third person. Like, I was watching this girl walk around and do this, and I was just like, either I had to accept her and become her and be okay and fuse those two individuals, or discontent and unhappy and depressed and jump off the building.
You know, I've read this book, Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. Yeah, but this is like Anjali and Anjali.
Yes.
In one.
Yes.
Fighting against each other, trying to accept each other.
Correct.
And learning to coexist with each other. That was it.
Very well.
So what was it? What were the challenges you faced? Who helped you? And there are people who love to talk, right? They will discourage you. They will say, look, don't have dreams. Forget everything. If you are alive, be happy. And there are some people, or rather yourself, who says, alive is not the big thing. Being born is not the big thing. I need to live my life.
Okay.
So who helped you? Who didn't? What are the advices you remember that came by?
You know, it was like, my biggest ally through all of this has been my dad. Since we left together both as clueless from Chennai as to whether we would get a face or a life back. And we both gambled because the first, he said, you know, when you go into the surgery, there's no guarantee, right? And I was like, Dad, I'd rather live with some eyesight and try to grab life back rather than lose my entire eyesight and then not have attempted it. So every single surgery was a gamble. We didn't know if I would come out going in, but we were like, let's give it our best shot, which is what? Showing up, being brave. So it's all about showing up, right? So I think he has definitely helped and been very, because the thing is, when most, and this is where I feel like some critical decisions in terms of supporting my journey has come, is most parents, especially Indian parents, if something like this happens to their child, will hold on to their children. At that time is when he let me go.
Yeah.
When I had, I was in Chicago, I went through 3 surgeries while I was there. I actually enrolled in university between my first and second surgery.
Oh.
So this part was not done yet. So my first 2 years in university, I remember we were in Cleveland, and we'd gone to the Cleveland Clinic, which was pretty much, I mean, obviously world famous for, you know, possibly being the last bastion of maybe saying I could get my eyesight back. And they had just said, no, that's not going to happen. And we were both walking out. And so he asked me, he said, are you up to, you know, going to university? And he was like, I totally understand if you don't want to. So I was like, no, let's do it. And we walked into the mall, went to a sunglass hut, bought 6 pairs of huge sunglasses, and I lived in them for 2 years.
And that was not for aesthetic, I mean, that was not for the style. That was
It was
to protect yourself and give yourself that courage.
I needed to give myself the chance to. Because there were still 2-3 surgeries left. You can't explain it to people. And I, at that point, the situation was such that, you know, kids used to walk across the street when they saw me out of fear.
Yeah.
Because it's not easy.
So how was that? Today, you know, when we see someone who might be code affected, we look the other way. Like, you know, we can't touch you, we can't be next to you. At that point in time, when people look at you, your friends, you should be playing games with them, board games, cricket, whatever your game was. People would see you, they would go back home and tell their mother, you know, I saw someone like this, and this is how it was. You know they're doing this, but you still want to not listen to it. So at that point of time, how was it as an individual to know that your friends are not so comfortable with you around?
In fact, it's very very good that you brought it up, because they're not comfortable in 2 ways. One is that aesthetically and physically they're unable to be comfortable with it. The other, that the heaviness of the story, suddenly you're not normal anymore. Right. You can't be like, oh, I had, you know, I bought pink shoes. Or they don't even feel comfortable talking about that stuff with you, because suddenly your life is about all these, about life and death, right? So the way I looked at it is, I broke it down into small goals. Let's get to first year. Let me enroll in classes. Mm. Let me rush. I rushed a sorority, okay, in sunglasses, and people thought I was possessed. Mm. They thought I needed an exorcist. They thought I was hiding from
you.
The
were
KGB.
Possessed. You were possessed to live. You were possessed to come back to the Anjali who wants to live and enjoy the vigor and magic of life. That's what
exactly.
I see. That's what
that's,
I see.
That's what. But I will not say. Mm. I mean, while it wasn't easy, I wasn't ready to accept that negative kind of. For me, right? I don't. Mm. Even today, I don't accept somebody else making a decision for me, even if it's God. Mm. Okay, like I don't agree to being condemned. This is your life. Mm. I'm just like, let me see. I'll give it my best shot.
Does sympathy help you, or it affects you?
Sympathy, I don't personally not a big fan of. Yeah. It's like it's a pretty. I mean,
it makes you go back to yourself with it. Yeah,
I think it's a useless sentiment. I think it's,
okay. Before we move on, I mean, this is the kind of story that will. Make people believe CSK comeback. Okay, but tell me one thing. If I was to ask you a question, that morning, 16th of March 2002, I give you a chance to redo it. Give me an honest answer, ma'am. Give me a very honest answer. Okay. You know, we always say no regrets. What life has to offer will offer. That's how it is. And you've taken them in the best way anyone can take it. If I rewind you back to that morning and tell you, Anjali, you have another chance to relive that day, would you do it differently? Give me an honest answer and why.
I think in retrospect, now that I'm a lot older and I've been through, it is...
We're not old.
Older.
We've matured. That's all.
I there's two ways to look at it and I'll answer it in two ways. Are you telling me if no one went on that car journey, if I could rewind that way, then that would be great. Nobody really wants to go. I mean... Yeah. You don't want to live the last 15 years fighting. It's like very exhausting to fight, get up every day, keep battle.
Correct.
But I'll be honest. If, for example, I believe everything does happen for a reason. Sorry to be trite.
Yeah.
But my mom was also in the car.
Yeah.
Okay. So had I not been there,
sitting
in the front seat, she might have.
Yeah.
So,
right.
You know, not going there.
You'd rather
so
take
I would
it.
Rather
yeah.
take it. So we're
yeah.
just because I can.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
I don't know how it would have turned out. And she's the backbone of our family.
Mm.
So me, I can handle stuff. Me and my dad tussle it out. But she, I don't think we would. The four of us. I have a brother. I don't think we'd been if something had happened to her more than she was already hurt. I think anything more than that would have been too much. So in retrospect, I do feel that yes, that journey has given me a lot of a voice, given me an opportunity to help people. But I don't think anybody wantedly will want to repeat that.
Yeah, obviously.
Okay,
not.
It's
yeah, that's
really.
Right.
I would have liked to have had
today, how is Anjali's life? Inniki vande overku or aasai irukku, put makeup on, comb your hair, hairstyle, clothes, normal life. Today is a social media world, you want your photo to look perfect, correct? Not by filter, photoshop, ellame irukku. So inniki vande how is Anjali's life different, for the good or the bad? What can't you do that people do?
Okay, definitely biggest grouse that, you know, not a fan of, that I can't drive anymore, obviously,
okay,
because of the vision. So, you know, I always try to work as hard as I can or be in a position where I can be driven around.
Correct.
You know, driven around in a little bit, you know.
Very nice.
And, you know, so you have somebody to drive you and maybe somebody to hold your purse. So, nothing wrong with that. So,
give me your purse. I feel it's very heavy.
You know, so, I mean, I try to look at the lighter side of that rather than engage in, oh, I can't do. See, you can't do. This is a non-negotiable. So now, what next? What can I... But I can always work with the situation.
Mm.
And this is what I believe in. So that is a hard... And with the vision, for example, like distance and depth perception I don't have. So usually I will go, if I'm going to a new place, I will go before one day before, check out where the stairs
adapt
are.
Adapt to
get
it.
Get a little, you know, you don't want to fall on your face. See, the thing is, I don't want everybody to know my story unless they have to. So if I'm in a board meeting or in a college class or whatever, there's no need for everybody to know that, oh, this is your problem. So I'll go one day before, figure out what's happening. I wake up a little earlier, give myself a little more time. Makeup takes a little bit longer. But you know, I learned all of it. And because I want to play the game. See, the thing is, and I make this analogy and this difference often. Just because this happened, I don't want to go be in Paralympics. I want to run the Olympics only. Okay, that was always the plan and that continues to be the plan. So, and there's no place for...
You want that level playing ground to remain the same level where you excel.
Yeah.
And today, the person who's sitting beside and me, it amazes one and all, and amazes the journey of life itself. And neenga vandha or motivational speaker, it's easy to say a few words. I can say some really inspiring words, but when you've been right down there and you come back to this level with complete vigor and inspiration, you are worth that influencer tag and motivational speaker tag. Truly, you achieved it. That's one thing you do. You're also an identity advocate.